Assalamu alaikum class. So today we are moving towards analytical epidemiology. We have already covered descriptive epidemiology in detail. In descriptive epidemiology, we have covered cross-sectional surveys, we have covered case series, we have covered case report, we have covered longitudinal studies. Fine. So, in descriptive epidemiology, the researcher makes a hypothesis. And in analytical epidemiology, the researcher now analyzes his or her hypothesis and accepts it or rejects it on the basis of the evidence which is collected. Fine? In analytical studies, now the researcher starts analyzing things. So, learning outcomes of today's lecture are that we will be covering the analytical epidemiology and what are the study designs which come under the analytical epidemiology, what are the differences between these study designs, and what are the differences in the measures of association which we conduct under analytical epidemiology. Fine. So, moving forward, as I have already mentioned that we have covered descriptive epidemiology, which makes the base of the pyramid of the evidence which is generated in epidemiology. In descriptive epidemiology, a researcher writes a case report, he writes case series, he conducts cross-sectional surveys, he conducts longitudinal studies, he is interested in time, place, and person distribution, and then he generates the hypothesis. The hypothesis which is generated in descriptive epidemiology is now analyzed in analytical epidemiology. In analytical epidemiology, the researcher analyzes his things through two types of different studies: case control studies and the cohort studies. In analytical epidemiology, the researcher wants to measure the associations between risk factors and the outcome of interest. While the superior branch of epidemiology is known as experimental epidemiology, where the researcher experiments to accept or reject the hypothesis. So we have moved from descriptive epidemiology to analytical epidemiology, and today we will be discussing the two different study designs which come under the heading of the analytical epidemiology. Fine. So analytical epidemiology, as I have already mentioned, in which the researcher accepts or rejects the null hypothesis which he has made, there are two types of study designs which can be conducted. Number one is case control studies, and number two is cohort studies. The case control studies are actually known as retrospective studies, because they start with the diseased population and we go back in time to assess the measure of exposure. Fine. But in cohort studies, these are known as prospective studies, because the researcher starts the study with normal population and moves forward in time, and the disease occurrence takes place in front of the eyes of the researcher. So the basic difference between the two is that in case control studies, the disease has already occurred and the researcher goes back in time to assess the measure of exposure. But in cohort studies, the researcher starts with a normal healthy population, divides the group into two, the exposed and non-exposed, and then all the disease occurs in front of the eyes between eyes of the researcher between the exposed group and the non-exposed group. Case control study is a retrospective study, while cohort study is a prospective study which moves forward in time. This is the basic difference between the two major studies in analytical epidemiology. Let me again explain that in case control studies, the researcher starts with the diseased population, which is known as case, and the non-diseased population, which are known as controls, and retrospectively goes in time to assess that whether this group was more exposed or this group was more exposed to a certain factor, and then finds out the measure of association between exposure and the outcome of interest, which is the disease. But in case of cohort studies, the researcher starts with a normal cohort, which is a normal healthy population. And from then onwards, he divides the normal healthy population into two, the exposed population and the non-exposed population. Moving forward in time, the researcher sees that how many of the exposed population have developed disease and how many of the non-exposed population has developed the disease. And then he wants to measure the association between exposure and the outcome. Another important difference is that in case control study, the researcher calculates odds ratios, and in cohort studies, the researcher calculates relative risk. These ratios and relative risk measure the association between exposure and the outcome. I must say that time is the key to identify that what type of study design do you want to conduct. For example, in cross-sectional surveys, when we go into the community and collect the data, the disease and the exposure are present simultaneously in the population. It means in cross-sectional survey, the outcome of interest and exposure are present in a single point in time when the researcher is collecting data. But in case control studies, these are retrospective studies. The researcher starts the study when the disease is already present, and he wants to know that was this particular population which is diseased was exposed in the past to the risk factor, or whether the controls were also exposed or not exposed to the risk factor under consideration. So in case control study, the disease is present at this particular in time when the researcher starts conducting the study, and the exposure is measured in past. Fine, but in cohort studies, the exposure and disease both occur in future, because the researcher starts his or her study with a normal population cohort which is disease free. Then he divides them into two groups depending upon the exposure, and then follows over a period of time to assess the development of the new cases which are occurring in exposed population and non-exposed population. So this is important that you have to assess while defining that this study design is this. You have to identify that whether the outcome and outcome of interest and the exposure are present in relation to the time, whether they are present in time, this particular present time, or they are present in past, or they are going to occur in future. So this is the key to identify the study designs when you are given the scenarios in your exam. So today we will be just discussing case control studies in detail. As I have already mentioned, these are known as retrospective studies because the disease has already occurred. The researcher starts the conduction of the research already when the disease has already occurred, and he goes in the past and measures the exposure. So these are known as retrospective studies or case control studies. In case control studies, the researcher targets a population, divides the group into two, the diseased population, which are labeled as cases, and the non-diseased population, which are labeled as controls. Then in the past, he wants to assess that in diseased population, how many of them were exposed to certain risk factor and how many of them were not exposed to certain risk factor. And in non-diseased population, how many of them were exposed and how many of them were not exposed. Let me give you an example. For example, we as researcher want to conduct a study in those females who have developed breast cancer. Fine. And we want to assess that whether there is relationship with the intake of oral contraceptive pills in the past with the development of the breast cancer. So what we will do, we will identify the cases who are already suffering with the breast cancer. We will identify controls. These are those females who do not have this particular disease or they are not suffering from the breast cancer. And then we will go into the history. Some of them will be exposed and to oral contraceptive pills. They will become they will be dealt under this group. And some of them who have developed breast cancer have never been exposed to oral contraceptive pills. So they will be divided into this group. Again, all those females who are not suffering with breast cancer at this particular in time, some of them have taken oral contraceptive pills in the past. So they will be labeled in this group. And some of them have never taken oral contraceptive pills in the past. They will be labeled in this particular group. And then we will be analyzing the rate of exposure in diseased population and in non-diseased population to assess the associations between the two factors. So going further, why we call them retrospective studies? Because outcome of interest is already present in this time and we label them as cases. And in those area of interest where the outcome is not present, we label them as controls. And retrospectively, we want to assess that how many of them were exposed in both the groups. So in retrospectively, at this point in time, we start our study. We identify cases, we identify controls, and we look for the exposure in the past in case control studies. Again, to show the time that at this point in time, the researcher has started the study where the disease has already occurred. And in the past, we want to assess the measure of association with the exposure rates in case control studies. As the name is suggestive, it starts with cases and it starts with controls. So in case control studies, the cases are those who are diseased and controls are those who are healthy, and we compare and contrast them with the presence of the risk factors in both the populations. When we take cases and controls, we have to match them accordingly because we have to measure the risk and its association. So we cannot say that we are taking cases which are old enough and we are comparing them with the controls which are young enough. For example, if we are dealing with the breast cancer cases, we know that breast cancer usually presents itself after 50 years of age in females. So if the cases are of more than 50 years of age, we cannot take control of the younger generation or in children. We have to match the controls with the cases according to the age distribution. We have to take the cases and controls and match them according to the gender. We cannot take cases of breast cancer in females and we cannot take males in the control group, definitely. And the occupation should be the same. For example, there are certain diseases which lead towards the development of certain diseases. And if there are different occupations, there can be mismatching which can alter the results. For example, if we have taken cases of bladder cancer and they are occurring in rubber industry and we have taken control from the general population, then definitely we cannot assess the measure of association until and unless the control have the same exposure of the same occupation. So we have to consider that the cases and controls should match in respect of age, in respect of gender, in respect of occupation, and in respect of socioeconomic factors. For example, there are certain cases which are present in they are present in poor socioeconomic group. For example, if we are dealing with the cases of tuberculosis and we want to find out the association with the presence of Mycobacterium tuberculosis in the environment, we have to take all the groups from all the socioeconomic statuses. Or if we want to assess, compare the rates of tuberculosis in a specific community where the lower socioeconomic status population is present with large number of cases, we cannot take control from the elite class. So the matching should be done. The cases and control should match in all the aspects except the outcome of interest. The outcome of interest means the disease under study, which should not be present in control and it should be present in cases. For example, if you are dealing with cases of lung cancer and the controls are those who do not have the lung cancer, and we take sample from, let's suppose, Shakathanam Hospital, where you have selected 50 cases in which the male and female both are present, then control should also have both the genders with them. They should match in the age group. For example, if the lung cancer affects the higher age group, the control should have the same age group as the cases have. Other factors should also be matched before the finding the measure of association. The only difference between the two should be of the outcome of interest, which is lung cancer. But for the rest of the factors, they should match with each other. That's most difficult criteria for the case control studies, because it is usually difficult for the researcher to find out the exact match of a case in the form of control. It makes case control study a little bit difficult. Another example can be that if we have to compare the immunized population with the non-immunized population, and in Pakistani setup, you all know that the immunization is complete under 2 years of age, and whether the last immunization, which is the measles booster, is given on 15 months, then you have to consider that for the non-immunized population, you are taking the same group which matches with the age, which matches with the gender, which matches with the socioeconomic status, etc. So what are the basic steps of conduction of case control study? The first step is the selection of cases and selection of controls. The second step is you match cases and controls. We have discussed them. How do we do matching? Number three is to measure the exposure rates. And number four is measurement of association. So let's go through them one by one. So for selection of cases, what is important that you have to define the case. There should be a certain diagnostic criteria and there should be some eligibility criteria which should define a case. For example, if we are dealing with the breast cancer, there are multiple types of breast cancer. Let's say that we are interested in adenocarcinoma of the breast. And if we take adenocarcinoma of the breast, then there are different types of stages. There are four stages of adenocarcinoma. So if we are defining our case of breast cancer, then we will say that case will be defined on the basis of presence of histological findings, that only those females with breast cancer will be included in our cases who have adenocarcinoma and are of stage 2. So these will make a specific particular definition of a case. Or we can say that we, let's suppose the outcome of interest is the iron deficiency anemia. And we say that the iron deficiency anemia will be labeled on the basis of not only hemoglobin, but also with the total iron binding capacity as well. So you fix the certain criteria and only those cases will be labeled as cases which undergo through that selection criteria and the diagnostic criteria. And then you make an eligibility criteria that whether you are interested in dealing with only new cases which are occurring in that community, or you are interested in old and new both cases which are present in the community. So a researcher defines the case that what will be the inclusion criteria and what will be the diagnostic criteria to identify the case. Fine. Then another component is that you define the sources of case, that from where will you select those cases. One of the possibility is that you select the cases from the general population. For example, you go into a population in a community in a defined geographical area, and you want to find out that what is the number of the patients who are suffering from tuberculosis. They will be your case, and those who are not suffering from tuberculosis will be your controls. So you can go into the general population and you can identify cases. Another form can be that you can go into selected hospitals and you can select your cases from there. For example, if as epidemiologists we want to conduct case control study, we have the option that we can go to Gulab Devi Hospital, which is well known in Lahore for the treatment of tuberculosis. So we can select our cases of tuberculosis from that particular hospital. So it entirely depends upon the researcher that what is the definition of the case he wants to make, what should be the diagnostic criteria he wants to make, what should be the eligibility criteria of that particular case to be included in this study, and then from where the sources can be, what are the different sources of the cases, whether he wants to select the cases from the general population or he wants to select the cases from the hospitals. Fine. So moving forward, if the researcher has defined cases, now the second step is that he has to select controls. Now again, he has to define the controls. That controls are those who do not have this particular disease, which is the outcome of interest. He should be free from this particular disease. Fine. So the controls can be taken, for example, all those cases who are suffering from breast cancer, but they are not suffering from adenocarcinoma of the breast. Fine. So, but it will bring different questions in selection of control. Ideally, a control should be selected who should be disease free, but it will make the conduction of case control study very difficult. So there is a leverage that we can select our controls from different sources. So sources can be again the general population. For example, I have given you an example that you want to conduct a study to find out that is there any association between the socioeconomic factors and the development of tuberculosis. Then you will go into different populations and you will select the cases of tuberculosis, and all those who are not suffering from tuberculosis will be labeled as cases, and then you will check their socioeconomic status and you want to find out the associations between the two. Fine. So you can select the source controls from the general population. Another way can be that you can select the controls from the same hospital, those who are not suffering from this particular disease, but they have visited the hospital for any other particular disease. For example, if your cases are the patients of tuberculosis, then you can select your controls as cases who are coming to the dermatology department for other diseases like scabies, like alopecias, like hair falls, like melasma, etc. But they are not suffering from tuberculosis. So you can select your cases from the hospitals. You can also select the controls from the friends and family who have accompanied the cases. For example, in our setup, it is very common that the patient never comes to the hospital alone and he is always accompanied by the friends and the family, so who are not suffering from this disease. So it will be easy for the researcher to take controls of that particular case from the friends and family. But the only important thing will be that while selecting the cases and controls, matching should always be kept in mind, that the control should be of the same age, of the same gender, of the same socioeconomic status. The only difference between the case and control should be that the outcome of interest is absent in controls. Another type of source for the controls can be neighbors who are living in the close vicinity of the cases. But there are certain important parameters which makes the selection of controls as the biased selection. For example, if a patient, if a researcher wants to conduct a study in which he wants to find out the association of intake of alcohol with the development of gastric carcinoma, and he identifies the cases as the cases who are suffering from gastric carcinoma, and he takes the control from the same ward who are not suffering from gastric carcinoma, but maybe they are suffering from gastric ulcers, maybe they are suffering from esophageal varices, maybe they are suffering from some gastric erosions, gastritis, etc. But we all know as a researcher that alcohol intake is not only related with the gastric carcinoma, but it's also related with the development of esophageal varices. It is also related with the development of gastric ulcers. So if you take your controls from the hospital, sometimes the selection bias can alter your measure of association. So preferably as a researcher, it is said that the controls should be taken from the general population. The controls should be taken from friends and family. The controls should be taken from the neighbors. They should not be taken from the same hospital, from the same ward. And if the researcher has resource constraints and he wants to take the same controls from the same hospital, the ward should be different. For example, as I have already mentioned, that the cases of gastric carcinoma can be matched with the controls who are coming to the dermatology OPD for their complaints, and they have different complaints. They can act as controls for the cases of the gastric carcinoma if they are matched. Then going towards the controls which are taken from the family, again, it can make a selection bias because the genetics are same. For example, if you want to conduct a study in which you want to find out the associations between the genetic factors or the presence of BRCA gene, which is causing the breast cancer, and you have selected the controls from the same family, definitely the genetic material is the same and your measure of association can be altered. It can end up in selection bias from the researcher. Going towards the neighbors, again, if you want to find out the association between the exposure of the environment with the development of lung cancer, or exposure of the nuclear radiation with the development of thyroid cancer, or exposure of smog and development of the lung diseases, definitely the neighbors are exposed to the same environment as the cases are. Again, the selection bias can take place, and the results can be altered. So the researchers should be very smart enough to identify the controls for cases while studying the outcome of interest, and preferably he should select these controls from the general population, which is the most authentic and valid control, and they can give us true measures of association between case control studies. So what should be the number of controls? In larger studies with bigger population, case control ratio can be 1:1. In smaller studies, under 50 population, we can select 2 controls for one case. We can select 3 controls for one case. We can select 4 controls for one case. It depends upon the outcome of interest. If we are dealing with rare disease or if we are dealing with a common public health issue, that affects the number of case control ratio. And it also depends that what should be the sample size while conducting the study. It also affects the ratio of cases with controls. Again, I am re-emphasizing, the controls should be matched with the cases while conducting case control study. So what are different sources of cases? Cases can be diagnosed in the community. Cases can be diagnosed from a sample of the population. Cases can be diagnosed from the hospitals. cases can be diagnosed from single hospital, etc. And controls can be selected from general population. Controls can be selected from the hospitals who do not have the disease. Control can be selected from spouses. They can be selected from siblings. They can be selected from neighbors or any other associates of the cases. So the first step in case control study was the selection of cases and selection of controls. The second step is the once you have selected the cases and the controls, you have to match them. It means that the cases should have the same socio-demographic profile and other things which are similar to the controls. For example, all those who are outlined with red, these are the cases. They are suffering from a certain specific disease. And we have to find out the controls from the population. These controls have the same characteristics. It means they should be of the same age. They should be of the same gender. They should be of the same socioeconomic status. They should be going to the same occupation, etc. So I'm telling you again that matching is the most difficult component while conducting the case control study. Matching can be done in pairs. For example, if you have selected a case of a 3-year-old female baby who has presented in children's hospital who has suffered from rickets, so then the control will be a 3-year-old female girl of the same socioeconomic status, where the parents, if the parents of the case are educated, then the parents of the control should be educated again. And then the only difference between case and control is that the case is suffering from rickets and the control is not suffering from the rickets. Fine. The matching can be done in controls. Matching can be done in groups. For example, you have selected a number of cases and then you have selected a group of controls, and these controls have almost similar features as the cases have. And then you can subdivide them into different stratas. You can do stratification and then you can analyze them. You can divide them into different age groups and you can apply test of significance. You can apply them into different genders and then you can apply test of significance. So matching can be done in by single one-to-one matching, which is done in pairs, or it can be done in groups. When you are dealing with matching in groups, then you have to do the stratification and you have to do the multivariate analysis. So we have discussed group matching, we have discussed pair matching, and the third component is that we will go towards the measurement of exposure. And how do we calculate the measure of exposure? That we will go back to the basic study design, that there are cases who are diseased, they are divided into the exposed and unexposed population and the control who do not have the disease, and then they are again divided into exposed and unexposed group. So what do you do? That you have cases, you have controls, you take histories that how many of them were exposed and not exposed, and in this group how many of them were exposed and not exposed. You compare the histories and you draw conclusions and make assumptions. So what do you do? That for diseased population, you said that the exposed group, amongst the diseased who had the exposed, they are labeled as A. Those who have the disease and they were unexposed, they are labeled as B. Those who were non-diseased and they were exposed, they are labeled as C. And those who do not have the disease and they were unexposed to, they are labeled as D. So you draw a 2x2 table. So what do you do? That you always take cases and controls in columns and the risk factors present and absent in rows. So a 2x2 table is incomplete if it is not drawn in this particular form, in which you have to make a total column and a row total column. Row total and column total should be included always in the formation of 2x2 tables, because in 2x2 table there are 4 rows and 4 columns. Fine. So what do? That you label the cases and controls. All those cases in which the risk factor was present is labeled as A. All those cases in which the risk factor was absent was labeled as C. And all those controls in which the disease risk factor was present are labeled as B. And all those controls in which the risk factor was absent are labeled as D. Fine. And in total, you will make the row total as A plus B, the row total of risk factor absent as C plus D. And in all those cases where make the total of A plus C, and controls make the total of B plus D. And in the end, you have a grand total, which makes the A plus B plus C plus D. This is known as 2x2 contingency table, and it consists of 4 rows and 4 columns. Fine. So again, to show you that if the you have selected cases who are suffering from lung cancer and you have selected controls who do not have lung cancer. So all the cases who have lung cancer and they were exposed to smoking are labeled as A. All those cases who were suffering with lung cancer but they were non-smokers, they were labeled as C. Those who never had the disease but they were labeled as smokers were labeled as B, and non-smokers were labeled as D. So in row total and column total, you will add them. It's another presentation. Let's move forward. For example, this is the presentation that we have almost 35 cases with the lung cancer, and in 30 out of these 35, 33 were smokers and 2 were non-smokers. In controls, we had 82 controls, and out of these 82, 55 were smokers and 27 were non-smokers. So we can add them and make a total in smokers and a total of non-smokers, and we have a grand total. Let me emphasize here that if we have 2 values in a column, we can calculate the third value by subtracting them from the total. Fine. So let's suppose if I ask you that there was a researcher wanted to conduct a study in which he enrolled 117 participants, out of which 35 were suffering from the lung cancer. If this information is given, you can always count the controls by subtracting 35 from 117. So if I give you information that out of 117, there were 88 smokers. So you can always select, you can always get this value. You can always get this value by subtracting 88 from 117, and you will get this value. Fine. So the scenario in exam can come in which you have to build your 2x2 table very intelligently. And one of the important clue is that this grand total will tell you that whether you have constructed this table carefully or not carefully, because the column total and the row total should always be equal to the grand total. So next component is the analysis. Once you construct your 2x2 table, the next component is that you do analysis. And for analysis of case control studies, we do 2 types of analysis. Number one, we measure the exposure rates. And number two, we calculate the odds ratios. The most important measure of association in case control study is the odds ratio. But as your book has mentioned both the types of analysis, so we will be going through the both types of analysis. So what do you do in exposure rates? In exposure rates, you want to see that how many of them have developed cancer. For example, you will say that this exposure rate of smoking between the lung cancer was A over A plus C, which is 33 divided by 35, it will tell you that the exposure rate of smokers with lung cancer was 94.2%. And then going towards the controls, you will say that the exposure rate of the controls was B divided by B plus T. So 55 divided by 82 will give you the exposure rate of the controls. Fine. So it will be, as the value shows, that it will be 67%. So you will say that the exposure rate was much higher in cases as compared to controls. But this does not give us the measure of association. For measure of association, we calculate the odds ratios. Fine. In odds ratios, what do we do? That odds of having disease while exposure will be A over C. The odds of exposure in cases will be the ratio between A and C. So it can be written as A over C. And the odds of ratios between the controls will be B over C. So how do we do calculate the odds ratio? That odds ratio will be odds among the cases divided by the odds among the controls. And we take a cross product to controls the odds ratio, which is AD divided by BC. So this will be taken as odds ratio. So the value of odds ratio will tell us about the measure of association. If it is more than one, there is stronger association. If it is less than one, there is lesser association. So we calculate the odds ratio as a cross product between the factors. So the formula for the odds ratio will be AD over BC. And if the value becomes, let's suppose, 8 between the smoking and the lung cancer comes to us, then we will say that odds of developing lung cancers among smokers is 8 times more than the non-smokers. So it will show that they have a higher risk of developing the lung cancer, which is 8 times higher than the non-smokers. So it tells us about the measure of association between the two factors. So for this, now I have two questions for you. Number one, you have to tell me, can we calculate incidence in case control studies? Justify your answer. And number two is, for the given scenario, calculate the odds ratio. For the example which I have given you the data, you have to calculate the odds ratio and you have to tell me whether there is an association and how will you interpret your results. Your submission time is 20 minutes from now. Thank you so much.